Nomura Shihan. She started Aikido in Los Angeles in 1975. And as I mentioned earlier, she's a quite small stature, and she would often be the person who would, the teacher would challenge to throw as part of the intro class. So she had a very interesting experience early on in an Aikido class, and she quickly, in a few years later, in 1979, opened her own dojo in West Los Angeles. And she also began her Iaido study in 1982 with Mitsuzuka Takeshi Shihan of Shindo Munen Ryu Iaido. She's not just an Aikido pioneer, she's also really been a pioneer in as a pharmacist. She was one of the first women and Asian American pharmacists to work in the Los Angeles area. And I like the story she tells of one of the hospitals she worked at having to construct a bathroom for her because there was no female bathroom in the hospital. So she's also had a lot of experience, you know, being Japanese American in both the growing up in Oakland and in Los Angeles and some of her experiences around that. So thank you very much, Nomura Shihan, for joining us. If you can just, again, we wanted to get started because of your health sciences background. Just what are your thoughts on COVID and its effect on Aikido and your own dojo? And you just want to go ahead.
Yes, well, first of all, COVID-19, the virus, is very infectious. And besides that, it's contagious. And it has no effective vaccine right now. So it's really very, very important and imperative that everyone practices preventive measures, takes preventive measures, which includes social distancing of 6 feet, covering your nose and mouth to protect others, and then others should wear coverings for the nose and mouth to protect you. When you wear, face mask or whatever, you're not doing it to protect yourself. So I want that clear because many people think, oh, I put a mask on, now I'm protected. No, you aren't. It's the others who have to be wearing, covering their nose and mouth to protect you if they are infected. The other important thing is to disinfect your hands, and I think soap and water is the best way to do it because the coronavirus is very fragile. The little spikes, you can break it up just with lathering with soap and water. But if you don't have access to soap and water, then of course sanitizer would work well. It tends to be drying because it contains alcohol. So I do that whenever I leave or enter my home and wherever I'm touching, it's like doorknobs or even doorbells or elevator bells where a lot of people have handled those surfaces, then, you know, it's good to sanitize your hands. Mm-hmm. But I don't think you have to go. Mm-hmm. You don't have to go crazy trying to clean your hard counters, you know, like granite tops or that, because apparently the coronavirus does not really stay that long, and it's not that contagious on those surfaces, like what was said in the beginning. So, some people go crazy, you know, just trying to scrub down those surfaces.
Yeah, how about dojos? Yeah. What are you thinking in terms of dojos?
Yeah. For training?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, you would still have to have those protective measures because there is no vaccine. Mm-hmm. And there's really no medication that cures it. Until the vaccine comes, one that's effective, you should still keep you cover your nose and mouth, keep distance of 6 feet. And if there's a filter in the dojo, you have to make sure there's a HEPA filter or filter that filters out bacteria and viruses, because otherwise it's just recirculating the air. And when you practice in the dojo, you should have good airflow. And the number of people training should be limited by the space you have to maintain 6 feet distance. And you shouldn't really be doing pair work, because you would have to be closer than 6 feet. I think Bokken, Jo, and Iaido are good practices within the dojo, because those can be solitary. Also, we have virtual classes from the dojo with one of the instructors conducting Aikido movements that are related to the Aikido techniques, and that has worked well. We've started that in March, and we have a pretty good attendance. We have about 18 to 20 kids, you know, participating, and I participate too, virtually.
That's great. All right. Well, I guess why don't we back up a little bit and talk about your childhood growing up in Oakland, and just a little bit about your experiences being a Japanese American person growing up in California.
Well, I was born in Los Angeles. I have an identical twin sister, so if you see her, you might think she's me, but she's in Los Angeles. I'm up in San Francisco. We moved to Oakland when, I don't remember really when, because I must have been maybe 3 years old or not even five. But my parents were grocers. They had three grocery stores, and I remember just really being in one of the grocery stores. And the life was pretty normal until 1941, December 7th, when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor. And although there was anti-Japanese sentiment before then, it just escalated after the attack. And of course, with the news media, newspapers and television, so there wasn't television yet, radio, it just escalated the fear factor and racial prejudice toward Japanese. And then there was an executive order signed by President Roosevelt with Order 9066 on February 19th to 1942. It was to be effective in February 19th, 1942, to intern the Japanese into concentration camps. So the evacuation started with an assembly, and in California, it was in really awful places like Camp Ran Horse, where the horse stables were, and that's where they had to live for days until they were relocated over to the internment camps, which are really prison camps. They were like concentration camps. There were sentries, you know, with guns and barbed wire and so forth. Fortunately, my family didn't have that experience. My father somehow got permission from the government to relocate to Madison, Wisconsin. So in the spring of 1942, at 8 years old, we landed in Madison, Wisconsin. And when my father went to the capital of Madison to register that we had arrived, he was told that he couldn't live in Madison, you know. But then he showed them the document of, you know, federal document giving us permission. So we were allowed to settle into Madison. Mm-hmm. After a few months, there was a committee that was formed. It was called the Madison Committee for Relocation of Japanese Americans, because by then they realized that this group realized that the internment of the Japanese was not constitutional. And so they did whatever they could to relocate Japanese Americans, the young Japanese Americans in the camps. And interestingly, members of this committee included, lawyer and many representatives from Christian churches, and they were very successful in getting permission from the government to relocate young Japanese Americans into Madison.
I really
didn't get any prejudice in Wisconsin. However, there was a lot of prejudice in California, in the West Coast. It's terrible.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, we don't have too much time, so I guess we want to skip ahead to your discovery of Aikido. So I know you're from a family with a lot of samurai roots, correct?
No.
Oh, no? I thought they were Satsuma? No?
Not really, no. My family comes from what's called the Satsuma area in southern Japan. It's Kyushu, southern Japan, like typical Kyushu. And if anyone has read or seen the movie The Last Samurai, that takes place of that era. And my father used to tell me history stories about the Satsuma, Lord Satsuma, and what they did to defeat the Tokugawas, because they knew that Japan, if they didn't do something, Japan would become a colony of, the United States and Europe, like the rest of Asia was. So I used to be fascinated by these stories my father would tell me. And he would speak to us in English, because he came as a schoolboy from Japan and graduated from Lowell High School. So he could read and write English. And that interest was actually from my father. The only our siblings who were so interested in this, which is probably why I became interested in Aikido. I worked at UCLA, and a colleague mentioned, taking Aikido. And at the time, I didn't know what Aikido was, because I was interested in the physical fitness, but not interested in a martial art. So the friend told me, well, why don't you go to this club, at UCLA and just look. So I went to the first class, and I looked, and these big American young white guys, they're in that little me, I'm 4'10", 85 pounds, older, 41 years old, and I'm looking at that. And somehow it impressed me, I liked it. The first class, they were doing techniques, so then the big guys who didn't know any better would grab me, and I came home full of bruises on my arms. But somehow, I think Aikido just grabbed me, because for some illogical reason, I was very much attracted to Aikido, and decided that I was going to continue this. So I continued for a couple of years at the club, Aikido Club at UCLA, and then transferred over to Francis Takahashi, who had a dojo in Alhambra City, and then was there a couple of years, and then co-opened a dojo in West Los Angeles, called the West Los Angeles Aikido Institute in 1979. I was co-founder. And that actually develop my skills to operate a dojo, because that's mostly what I was doing. And then I first started teaching classes, although I was not a don yet. And then in 1981, there was a seminar introducing Chiba Sensei in it, with the guest instructors of Yamada, Kanai, Shihan, and then Chiba Sensei. And when Chiba Sensei appeared, goodness, I mean, here is a samurai, you know, just his whole persona was like the 19th century, you know, in the 1800s, the samurai coming on board. So that was very impressive. So after that, when he opened the dojo in 1981 in San Diego, then we went and joined him. And then he became my master teacher. And we would commute from Los Angeles maybe monthly. I would commute monthly to San Diego. So I was not one of his Kenshi Sei, but more on the an outlying student of his. And
Is there anything else you want to know? Chiba Sensei's Aikido was very big and very physical. I mean, as a smaller person, did you find that challenging, or did you, how were you able to make Chiba Sensei's Aikido work for yourself?
Well, I didn't really find it challenging. I mean, I think in UCLA, Aikido club is more challenging because they had the big muscular guys who had no idea, you know, and they would use me to demonstrate unbendable arm, because Koichi Tohei style was the, you know, the big circles and moving your center hara and the unbendable arm, so which I was pretty good at. And so they would have me demonstrate, have someone, a big guy from the audience who came to watch a class the beginning of the semester come, and there would be many, many big, you know, students, male students, no females. And then they would try to lift me, and they couldn't, because I would use this unbendable arm, you know, this weight heaviness. And that would impress them. So they would all, you know, register to take Aikido, but then after about 1 month, they drop out because they found it wasn't that easy. So I mean, getting back to Chiba Sensei, he did not give me too much personal instruction. He encouraged me, but I would watch and see what he was doing and then internalize it. So instead of depending too much on verbal instruction, I would pick up by, like he would say, stealing the technique, you know. And that's the way I learned from him. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, and you didn't feel any limitation being a smaller person. You felt like it would work for you?
No, I didn't.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, I didn't at mm-hmm. all, you know. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, as I said, I felt that Aikido grabbed me. I didn't grab Aikido so much as Aikido grabbed me and wouldn't let go. And so it's...
They're going to hear me.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't think about, you know, I can't do it. I thought, I can do this.
Mm. All right, great. And then I think we only have a few minutes. Am I correct?
I don't know.
Yeah, all right. Well, I'll ask one more question. So what advice do you have? We were talking about that a little bit with Christina Varjan Shihan. What advice do you have to people for maintaining a lifelong practice? I mean, you started a little bit older, so how do you make it work for a lifetime?
Well, I think, first of all, you have to really enjoy practicing Aikido, and you have to, I mean, I trained every day. I'm talking, you know, Sunday through Saturday. Every day I would practice Aikido, Iaido, the weapons and everything, not weapons, like both in jewel and the sword, I would practice that every day for 20 years until I moved to and opened up the Aikido Institute of San Francisco in 1999. And even then, I continued every day. Until later on, as I got older, I slowed down. And I think that to sustain a practice in Aikido, you have to realize that you can't be doing the same thing when you're 30 or 40 years or old or 50, that you have to start evolving your practice, because I'm 86 now, 86 and a half, and I certainly cannot do what I did 20 years ago, you know. So I have evolved now into what is called a technical director. I have the younger students, the instructors who are teaching the classes, and I'm on the mat, and I'm just, you know, critiquing. I'm not teaching so much as just sort of like the coach. Mm-hmm. And I think that, and I started doing that, I think, I started gradually doing that when I turned 75, because I felt at 75 I needed to let the other younger people have the opportunity to teach and evolve in Aikido, because you really evolve when you teach classes. And then when you have a dojo, it's a different type of thing. You're still evolving. And so I decided that I was not going to, at 75, I was not going to teach at seminars anymore, because I wanted to use my energy to develop my students to become teachers. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a matter of evolving yourself and not doing the same old thing, you know, for years and years and years. Think of the future.
Yeah, I had mentioned earlier that you have a really dedicated bunch of younger students, many of them younger men. What's your secret for, you know, attracting and retaining younger people in your dojo?
Well, I think now with all the, well, earlier when, you know, when I first opened the San Francisco and also Los Angeles, I would wonder why people would be coming to my classes, because here, you know, I'm not the ideal, you know, vision of an Aikido, I mean, a martial arts person, right? So then when I asked, they would say, well, and this, I, you know, police officers don't need this, because I was teaching police officers too. And the answer would be, well, when I see someone small like you doing what you do, it's inspiring. You know, I mean, you can just, there has to be something to this practice. If someone small, a female, can do what she's doing. And I think that's where women have to believe that, you know, that especially for women, you know, don't think that you're not as good as the men. I mean, you have other attributes that are as good as or better than the male. I mean, but remember, you are a female, right? So you need to have confidence in yourself that you can do this, that you can teach, and so forth. And there's one thing that I want to quote Dr. James Allison, who was a pioneer in immunotherapy to fight cancer. And he believed in this immunotherapy. He worked 40 years to find the solution. And he never gave up. And this is what he said: that if you find something you really love and think about all the time and gives you joy, don't worry about what's going to happen. And I think those are really wise words for anyone to just remember that.
That's great. That's perfect. Yeah, that's especially right now when a lot of people are in a lot of confusion and doubt. That's really great. All right, I think we have time now. Yeah, I think Jamie, okay. Is it time? Should we switch over?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much, Nomura Sensei. We really appreciate it. And everyone, please visit Aikido Institute of San Francisco and experience this great training with Nomura Sensei.
Thank you.